Wednesday night. It is the Metal Summit. We are your place to be. November 11th, it is National Metal Day, and you are spending it here with us, 11-11. We are your Island of Misfit Toys. This is the place that you need to be halfway through the week, getting yourself to the weekend. As always, I'm here with Angel, Jason, Bobby, myself, Jay. And before I kick it over to our guest of the evening, I'm actually going to kick it over to our very own Psycho Steve, who had a little something that he wished to start off this episode with. Steve, it's all you, my friend. Take it away.
Thank you. So I just wanted to say, unfortunately, there was a metal brother that has passed away yesterday out of Long Island named Jimmy Chinney. I don't know if you guys know. He had a podcast. He was also a promoter out of Long Island, New York. And unfortunately, he did pass away from kidney failure. So I just wanted to say to his friends, family, we mourn his loss, but celebrate his memory. And thank you for all you've done for the metal community in New York and everywhere. We'll miss you, and we love you. Thank you.
Absolutely. No, for sure. We appreciate everybody in the community and everybody who's touched anybody in any way, whether it be music or sports or anything like that. Anything that's a positive figure, anybody who brings joy, we are always happy to be connected with that person. And Steve, we definitely, you know, give you love and support, brother, on your loss.
Thank you.
For you fans, thank you all so much for tuning in with us this evening. Thank you very much for taking a second so that we can do that. And let's bring in our special guest of the evening. We do very much appreciate his time for taking it out to rock with us. Guitarist extraordinaire, Mr. Chris Caffrey. How are you, sir?
What up, yo? you speak of him passing. Yesterday, I had he obviously was close to a lot of people in this community, but there was a lot of friends of mine that I saw that were weeping for some reason, and I was going to them like, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" And it was all for him. So yeah, he was definitely someone that was missed to a lot of people in the community. Once we've had a lot of losses in the last few years in this community, a lot of crew people with TSO, a lot of band people, and other things. So I know what everybody goes through in that kind of situation, and it's something I think that we never ever get ourselves used to. Everybody says you need to prepare for things like this as you get older, but you know, you just never really know when your time is going to be. So everybody just take the time to appreciate everybody you have in your lives while you can, because life is definitely one of those things where you blink your eyes and something happens you weren't expecting. So just a little shout out for everybody to remember their angels, but also give a lot of love to the people they have in their lives every day as well.
Amen.
100%. Amen. Especially around these times where we've been very, very close to monitoring the situation, looking out for family members, trying to keep as many people to a minimum that we're hanging out with on the regularity, as well as the people that we invite to our houses, the houses that we go to and everything. And on that topic, Chris, talk a little bit about what you had going on at the beginning of this year, which then led into the COVID and kind of the strange situation that the music industry hasn't yet had to deal with, that we had to face in 2020. So talk a little bit about what you had going on and what you've been doing with the time.
Well, it was kind of odd because I don't know why. I mean, it was one of these things where I saw some news coming out in January, and I started paying really close attention to this whole virus situation then, and I was watching a lot of the black market news out of China, and I just said to a lot of the people that I worked with in my own inner circle, I said, I don't think this is going to be something that's going to be very good. I thought we were going to finally see something like this happen where it was really going to affect us, and I actually started buying masks and things like that in January because I take care of my mom, and I just wanted to be in a situation where I had myself protected if anything happened. But it actually flew down to the state of Florida in February, and I had masks on my airplane, and people were asking me what I was doing, and I said, well, you may not know right now, but I think it's going to be something you might all be doing in a little while. And I got home into New York, and then it just started here, and it hit really quickly. So I was in the process of writing music for a new Spirits of Fire record, and that's pretty much what I planned on doing with everything this year. And it's just kind of, it overtook a lot of things out of the gate in New York, because we had massive death numbers. You know, the cases weren't anywhere near where they are right now then, but the fatalities were very high because we didn't know who to hide, who was it was really hitting the hardest, and we didn't have any of the treatments. So, you know, New York was seeing 750 deaths a day. Me and my mom were watching TV, and it was one of these things where you just couldn't believe it. And so I've taken it very seriously since day one, and I was kind of worried about what was going to happen with the music industry. A lot of my friends were convinced that they were just going to be able to schedule their tours from the spring until the summer, and I was like, I don't know. And TSO, I think we held on as long as we possibly could. The plan for us was originally to wait and see what was going on by the end of June, and then we were like, okay, we'll see July and August. We really just kept holding on, hoping, you know, that everybody was going to get this together so we could safely go out and tour. But unfortunately, there was I like to call it a lot of miscommunication on exactly what it was we were dealing with. This put us into a worse situation than we needed. There was no way we were going to get rid of this thing, but I think we could have controlled it a lot better. And now we just put ourselves into a position to where we have to ride the wave. So I just kept writing and doing a lot of art, and I have a pretty decent yard here. I put a 9-hole golf course in my yard.
Nice.
I put a beach down at the Little River, so I had everything I needed here other than, it was like building Rock Ridge, but I didn't have the people. You know? It was just like, I got everything I needed, because I didn't want to really leave too much with the situation with my mom, but I didn't also want to, I wasn't a fan of going out there and being a part of the world that wasn't the world that I was used to. I saw so much of it on TV and on Facebook and everywhere, and it was just like, well, I want to go outside and experience life the way I knew it as much as possible. And then we made the announcement that the TSO tour wasn't happening. And I released a single that was called Sick of This Shit. I don't know if you guys.
Yep.
That was a pretty cool metal song. I did it with the bass player TSO, and John Macaluso played drums on it, actually, over in Italy, which I thought was a little bit of a cool connection, because Italy had gotten hammered pretty bad by this. I know when I was speaking to the people at Frontiers in the beginning about the Spirits of Fire thing, they were all locked in their houses, and that's when they were in the situation where they were choosing what people, the hospitals could take. You know, because when this first came out, we really didn't know exactly what it was. You know, it kind of blindsided us. It was like I call it like a virus Pearl Harbor. You know, it just snuck out of nowhere, and not that we're able to stop it now, but we're at least doing a heck of a lot better in keeping people alive than we were back then. Back then, it was one of these things where, you know, 85% of the people that got to a ventilator died. It was that bad back then. So, you know, TSO, we were just always talking about trying to get something going, so we set it up to have that pay-per-view, the Christmas Eve and Other Stories Live on December 18th. So we're going to get together and, you know, do our masked rehearsals and just really try to do what we can to give the fans something. So, I mean, we spent 21 years on the road where every November I was gone. You know, I was never home in this time of the year. I was telling you guys before we got on here that this is the first time that I actually got to finish raking the leaves in my lawn. I always leave when fall just started, you know. I would never see the oaks fall, and it's just kind of bizarre. This is right now, is usually this Wednesday is most of the time the very first day of the TSO tour would be right around this day, and then, you know, I wouldn't be home again until New Year's Eve or New Year's Day, or sometimes the first week in January. So we'd always be gone by the end of October, and it's a little bit different, but you know, I think everybody's, you know, we're all sick of this shit, but I think we're all handling it pretty well for the most part. You know, this has been a difficult year all the way around, but I think that it's been a for me, it's, I think it's been a little bit more of a mental test than I wanted it to be sometimes, because studying this virus so much, I knew that there were so many other things that we could have done to save lives, and I watched a lot of people argue in and out about things about it, and I got frustrated with it, because, you know, people would be like, shut up, guitar player, what do you know? And I'm just like, well, it's not guitar player, what do I know? I just want to try to help people, maybe save somebody's life. But, you know, it's at that point now where everybody's got their own beliefs, and we just got to ride the wave, and hopefully 2021 we can get back out on the road, and the vaccines will work, and we'll be looking back at this, at that, like I said, the year of the vacuum, 2020. Let's say it sucks, so it's like, that's kind of where I'm looking at the whole thing, you know. I'm tired of a lot of what we've been having to go through as it's going on. You know, the political side is draining and everything like that. It's weird, but I mean, we're human beings and we're stuck out of our elements, and you know, it's kind of one of these cabin fever sort of things, I think, that's kind of taken over everybody. And I think for the most part, we're doing a pretty good job handling it, and just hopefully we can get through it. And, you know, now as we get deeper into the flu season, maybe, you know, buckle down and really see what's going on with it and realize that this thing is not going away until we make it go away. You know, it's not just going to disappear. You have to do the right things right now, because it's there. I mean, it's weird. It's like the invisible demon. You can't see it. You know, it's hard to sit there and go, wow, it's there. And you don't know it's there or where it is, but it's there, and it's kind of like food poisoning. You know, it's like, I ate this piece of fish. It looked like a piece of fish, so it's like I went breathing on my way to the grocery store, and I got this thing in my fucking lungs that wants to kill me. So it's interesting, but you know, I've got a lot of artwork done. It's kind of weird. People are like, you must be doing a ton of music writing, and I don't think it's really gotten me to the point where I'm inspired to write yet. It's weird. I think I'm still trying to get a lot of it into grips in my head as far as what I want to write about it. So I think this is going to be more one of those things where when it's all done, I'll be writing. Because I think we're still living it. So it's kind of like, you know, the Rime of the Ancient Mariner, trying to write that song before the story was done. It's just like I'm living this little dream or nightmare or whatever it is right now, and when it's all over, I think I'll write a little bit more as far as songs that were inspired or uninspired by this.
Absolutely, 100%. That's actually a lot of the one very live show and stuff like that. And then when COVID hit and canceled everything and then gave us all free time of our own, we really were able to buckle down, kind of use this as a bit of a platform to really be very positive, talk to the artists about what they were doing, what they want to talk about, and really just kind of do our little part to keep music alive with us not being able to go to concerts.
Yeah, no, and I've seen the music world come together in this situation through the media like this, which has been really cool. I mean, I've done a few of the Zoom things. I kind of hermited myself away from things a lot more than other people have, but you know, I'm watching it, and I think it's really good that we have been able to sit and talk. I mean, I have pinball machines. You can see some of the lights flashing behind me, reflections, and you know, every Thursday in the county I live in New York, there's always competitions, and there's a lot of people that have machines in their houses, and at first they were doing the virtual tournaments through things like this, and that kind of started right away, and then you started to see the musical jams and things like that happen, and it's I think in that sense we were very lucky to have this part of the communication that we were able to have, because I can only imagine how bad things might have been if we were as uninformed as they were in something like 1918 about what was going on in our environments around us, and our inabilities to communicate with people might have made us a little bit more careless in general as far as like what we would be doing. So I think this has got everybody connected, but in some ways I think it actually helped save a lot of lives to give everybody a chance to stay safe at home in the middle of this, because it's, you know, it's not going to kill everybody, but it's killing a lot of people, and it's definitely changed the way that I think a lot of us think of how we, you know, we do our hygiene and things like that. So in the future, I think it's really going to help us in situations like the normal flu season. I think that, you know, in the future with that, we're going to notice that we'll be able to handle the normal flu season better, because I think people are just going to treat the quote-unquote viruses differently, you know, as we go into the future and be a little bit more on that Asian model of how, you know, you really, you know, we're not going to wander around masks every day of our lives, but just to really clean up and realize just how easy something like this can spread and get into you. Because I've had a lot. I've known a few people that have died. I know a lot of friends that lost family members. We lost some TSO fans, some fans that have been there every year for 15, 20 years at the shows, and you turn around and people are talking about it online, and so-and-so passed away, and it's real. I mean, if you have 240,000 people that have died out of 340 million, we're not all going to know somebody. So when people are like, I don't know anybody that died, it's like, but that's doesn't mean that 240,000 is not a large number of people just because you don't know somebody that died. It's a very, very large number of people. It's about almost, I think we've reached almost 80 times the deaths of 9/11 from this right now. So there's a lot of people. So we still have a little ways to go. And like I said, I'm hoping in the future we're able to deal with things like this a little bit better than we did, because we, not that we were spoiled, but we had, you know, things come and go, and they hit us, and they kind of hit certain groups of people and certain transmissions and certain things. But this one kind of globally woke everybody up as far as how something like this could reach everyone.
Absolutely, 100%. Bobby Dreyer, I believe it's all you, my friend.
So, Chris, I'm going to throw this out. So you did a killer album in 2019 with Tim Ripper Owens, you know, stellar. How did that project come about? I mean, you got your solo stuff, you got...
Ripper and I have known each other since I met Ripper in Cologne, Germany, in a press thing that was called, I think it's called PopCom, I believe that's what it was, in Cologne, and he was there doing press with KK Downing for the first record he had done with Priest, and I was over there with Johnny Lee Middleton, and I think we were doing, it might have been Wake of Magellan at the time, so I think that was around like 1997, and we just became friends, and then Sabotage toured Europe with Priest, and he lived outside of Cleveland and Akron, so he would come see us a lot. And I did a song on his first solo record, and I did actually his last solo tour with him. And that we got to go to Europe and play the last Heaven and Hell tour, so we got to spend a little bit of time with Ronnie before Ronnie had passed away. The Frontiers contacted me, and they were just, you know, they had all those project bands, and I was like the person that said, I'm never going to do something like that, because I just didn't want to be, you know, involved in that many different things. But they said they wanted to use Ripper and Roy Z, and both, you know, I never worked with Roy. I loved a lot of his work. I loved those couple Dickinson records he did. I mean, I was a real huge fan of Roy's work and the Halford stuff. So it just kind of all worked out with that. It was a lot of fun, that record. I wrote a lot of the music, and Roy wrote a couple songs, and I'm working on the new one now. I just don't, it's funny with that. I don't want to talk too much about it right now, but there's still a little bit of uncertainty as far as who's actually going to be doing a second Spirits of Fire record, which is why it's kind of been in the quiet zone during this whole thing. But I've like 15 songs written, but we're just getting things all together with it right now, because it's just weird, you know, people go through their things with the music business, and I act a little bit differently to it. I think maybe it has to do with some of the facts that I just don't really ever care about the financial end of it. It's not that I don't need money, but I never look at things by a dollar. You know, I like to do what I do. So if somebody wants to give me $50, I'll do it. If they want to give me a ton of money, it's like, I'm sorry, but a lot of things I just don't want to do. You know, I'd rather stay home than go and give myself to something like that. So, you know, sometimes you deal with that thing, you know, where the financial thing has to come into play. And I just kind of like, look, I want to the reason why I stayed away from a lot of these other things was to get away from that part of the business. I wanted to do something for fun. So I'm like, don't take away the fun out of the thing I was doing for the fun. So, but I got some really good music written for it. I think the music I have written for this record is actually a little bit cooler than the first one. Not that the first one wasn't cool, but I think I was really focused in on what I wanted the second one to sound like. So hopefully by the middle of 2021, there'll be a new Spirits record out.
Chris, you were a big Gibson guy. Who are you using now? And I'm a guitar whore, so, you know, having a studio like yourself and everything. So,
it goes by a lot of times what I'm doing in the studio as far as which guitars I think will sound better for things. I have a couple guitars that just record better than other ones. They always have and they always will. And that one Randy Rhoads guitar that Jackson made me for Sabotage, I believe it was in like 1999, that always records really well. I have a couple Gibson V's that record great. I bought last year on the road a gold Strat because I always wanted a gold top, and I bought one. And that guitar, I actually put a Malmsteen single coil in it at the bridge. And that guitar's got a really, really, really great rhythm sound for recording because it's not exactly a humbucker, but it gives you a really nice bright sound. So with that, I like to multi-layer different guitars. I used to just do stereo rhythms, two, but now I'm actually at the point where I like to do six, and it's a pain in the butt. I don't use the direct signal, but I like to have the direct signal because yeah. You're editing, it's real easy to line up rhythm guitars with that because you just get the video game becomes easier to move. So I'll do like two guitar tracks, a left and right with the Strat, and I'll do two with another guitar that I think has the good main rhythm sound for. I have a Luke guitar that I really like that has got a great sound, and I have an SG that I picked up that has a great recording sound and a couple of Les Pauls, and I'll just take them and blend them, and I'll give one guitar more distortion, one guitar less distortion, and just kind of have it to where those three guitars on each side come together to sound like one giant guitar. And it's kind of been something I like. And Paul used to, Paul O'Neill kind of got me into that. He liked to have two main rhythm guitar sounds done, and then he liked to have me do, which was a pain in the butt. He would get a telly, and I would play a clean, just the sound of the pick on the strings for a clean thing that he used to give the clicking of the guitar and with the thing. So you would have to go through and do all your guitar tracks with this little clicky telly thing that went in stereo with everything. And it actually did bring out some of the sounds of the rhythms a little bit more, like pointed in things with that. It was a clean telly track. And I think there might have been times when we never really needed to use it, but it just became part of something that we did every time. Having the clean telly track, so yeah. I do the clean telly thing with the Strat guitar, it's kind of a cleaner, thinner, hard rock metal sound that I use to get that kind of spiky bit into the rhythms. But I did that on that Sick of This Shit single, and that was six rhythms in that song, and it just made to sound like two, like the stereo left and right. You wouldn't know it was six. But that, like I said, is real easy to edit, to get together by having that direct. Because without that direct, you're just sitting there looking at a bunch of muffs. I mean, it's really hard to figure out exactly getting in between notes. And then if you want to line it up with drums. And, drummers always think they're perfectly on with the click. They are not.
nudge.
Humor them. There is, guitar players are always ahead of the beat. It's like, a lot of times your snare hit is actually a little bit behind the beat, but, so you go through that, at least when you have that thing, and I don't like to sit there and line everything up, by pressing the buttons and doing it that way. I kind of like to let the drummer's track breathe, and then this way I can move right along with its kick and snare better by having direct line to do it that way. So I'm an editing freak. I edit the editing. I'll get in there and take drum shots and clean up every tom track and remove, you know, all the room noise around the toms. I'll sit there between guitar parts where there's the smallest break, and I'll cut out the guitars so that the track is really super clean. So a lot of my recording takes longer than it should because I just go crazy on the editing side.
So are you a perfectionist?
Absolutely, for sure. Psycho Steve, why don't you jump in, my friend, and then Angel, why don't you pick it up so we can get the fans involved?
Okay. Hopefully Johnny Mac isn't watching this because he's going to hear this. Might kick your ass. Just
Mac,
saying.
Mac was better than most of them, actually. But he, nobody's perfectly on everywhere. But he was really, you know, who was actually really, really, really good, almost dead on with the click on everything, is Tishy.
Yeah.
He did my last two solo records.
Oh, Brian.
He's a machine.
Yeah.
He's a machine, that guy. And his sounds, like, I didn't have to do anything to them. Not that I had to even with Macaluso, but the great drummers, their sounds are the sounds that you get samples from. You know, when I saw that when I first did Metallium with Tirana, and I was watching him hit his snare, and he just hit that thing so freaking hard, and then it was just, his snare sound was what everybody started using. It was just, you know, great drummers are always right there, but there are some that, you know, they're not always directly on with the click, but I let them believe that they are.
All right, so my question is, what made you pick up the guitar? Like, what concert, your first concert you went to, and you're like, I'm going to go play guitar?
I think it kind of came out of just, I started listening to the Beatles when I was real young, like maybe three. You know, I got into that. I loved that sound, and there was stores, like Sears Surplus was a store, and they just had a guitar section of the store, and I liked looking at them, and I thought that that was just what I wanted to do. I know when I was in kindergarten or first grade, I was like either 5 or 6 years old, and I sang Help for Show and Tell, so I think that that's just what I wanted to do, and I was like, well, guitar was cool. I bought Kiss Alive when I was really young, and Wings Over America was the first hard rock metal record that I had in my collection. There's a lot of really heavy stuff on that, and I just would stare at those pictures of the double neck guitar and the Les Paul, and I just really got into guitar. And then my brother was a drummer, and you know, I took drums in school because they didn't have guitar classes, and my brother had the sticks and the pad, and my family had no money, so we didn't need two drummers though. And when I realized that drums, you know, were drums, I was like, I want to, no offense again to the drummers, but I wanted to write music. I wanted to make the notes, and since my brother was a drummer, I went into that, and I started taking lessons when I was 11, and I, you know, a lot of the stuff I did after that, self-taught. I'm pretty much self-taught, but I've had a lot of amazing guitar players that have played with me, that have taught me, you know, Chris Oliva and Al Petrelli and people like that, that just taught me a lot throughout the years. So I had the pleasure of being able to learn with the people I was playing with. So I was kind of blessed in that way to have it differently.
Awesome.
Super duper cool. Angel, why don't you jump in, my friend? How are the Metal Summoners doing?
A whole lot of love from the fans. And somebody doesn't like Psycho Steve, Star Peter said, you stole both of the questions I was going to ask. You gotta stop.
I've answered half of people's questions in questions.
We love you, Star.
But we're gonna start out with some love from the fan zone. Kim Sullivan says, Chris, I was really lucky to have seen you when Sabotage came through my city in 1987. You were the touring guitarist for the Hall of the Mountain King at the time, the linear notes for that album. I'm sorry, I'm just reading. The linear notes for that album had band members giving themselves roles instead of listing their instruments. Did you eventually get a quirky name too? And if so, do you remember what it was?
Well, I mean, when I went to audition for Sabotage, and anybody who knows the story is actually kind of pretty pretty funny with the Sabotage thing, because Paul O'Neill was producing Heaven. I was playing guitar in Heaven, and I got that gig when I was 17. He was my first producer and my first manager, really, and he started working with Sabotage, and he said he was producing this record called All the Mountain King, but he said the sound was really huge, and he wanted to, he said they're a one guitar band, but he wanted to have them have a second guitar live. And Paul had a really good relationship with Wendy Dio, and he says, I think I'm going to be able to get these guys on the Dio arena tour. And he says, I want you to tour with the band. So I started learning their music, and I heard Sabotage on SOU, and I think Holocaust was one of the first songs I ever heard. I remember that. But I loved the riffs and the music. But when I heard 24 Hours Ago and that Mountain King record, I was just like, wow, I played to that music, and it just felt like something I would have written myself. And when I was playing along with those records, like, I learned every Sabotage song, except for a lot of the ones on Fight for the Rock. I learned almost every song they had, but I knew them, and I'm like, was really excited to play with the band. And they said they got the Dio tour, and I was going to be doing the tour. Then all of a sudden, not Paul, there was another manager working with, they called me up and said Sabotage had somebody else that was playing guitar on that tour. And I said, what do you mean? I said, well, they hired somebody from Florida. And I said, no, they didn't. And they, what do you mean? I said, I'm playing. And I think I was 19 at the time. And I said, I want to play guitar in this band. And I said, look, here's what we'll do. I'll pay to fly myself to Florida to audition for these guys. If they like me, I'll let them have me stay and do the tour. If they hate me, I'll fly home, and I'll cover the flight myself so it costs nobody anything. So I get on there. They said, okay, I get on the airplane. I fly to Florida. Nobody comes to get me at the airport. 700 guys did not want another guitar player. Chris did not want another guitarist. They lied to the management and told them they had this kid in Florida that was going to be playing guitar and keyboards on the tour. He wasn't. They just told him he was, and they had this kid that was going to go out on a tour and travel with them and tinkle around on a couple notes on keyboards. He wasn't going to be playing. I walked in the room. They got me in a van, and I met Sabotage in the record plant when they were recording Mountain King, so they knew me. But they made me take a freaking taxi to that rehearsal place. Nobody came to get me. So I was like a pain in the butt to them at the time. And we plugged in, and they said, well, what do you want to play? I said, I don't know. Play anything. And they said, what do you mean? I said, play anything. And they looked at me, and they laughed. And I said, I know every one of your songs. And we played the Whip was the first thing they played. And they played that song, and they stopped, and they said, we got to leave, we'll be right back. And all four of them left the room, and they came back in, and they said, you're staying in Florida. And it was just something that happened. I can't explain what it was. And even Chris said it. He goes, this is so weird. He goes, it sounds like I'm playing with myself. But it was like it was two of him. And when we did the rehearsals for that Mountain King tour, he only had to teach me one riff out of all of the songs we played. And I did headline shows with them too, so I knew a lot of their songs. And it was one little thing in 24 Hours Ago where there's a open string before the da-da-da-da-dun, there was an open string there before that riff. And out of all the rhythm guitars for every Sabotage song they ever had, I played every one exactly like he did on the record, except for that one riff. And that was kind of where that started. So yeah, I pushed myself on them, but it wound up being, you know, that perfect little marriage. We were a very good band together.
And Bridget Sullivan, she's a huge fan. She has a comment. I love you, Chris. I don't have a question, but a statement. I saw you in the early 90s when I was 13. My step-uncle's band, Trouble, opened for you. And I remember being in the front row and was very blown away. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that was a fun tour, that whole time. I mean, that's the MTV times of heavy metal. It was Trouble was a great band. That band was such a great live band, but they were such a mess on the road. They were funny because they would argue with each other. They would stay in different hotels. They would show up and I'd be like, well, there's half the trouble. Where's the rest of them? We talking to each other last night. they would just get arguing with each other and go to a different hotel. But they were such a great band. They were fun to watch. I used to do their lights. They were opening for us, and I would go back there and play with the light board. So.
And just want to thank all of the fans watching. John, Cindy Craig, David Rosenfeld, Angela Myers.
Thank you.
And on to more fan questions, and there's a few. Jennifer wants to know, what are you most proud of from your extensive career? I love your solo stuff.
Wow. I think probably my very first solo record was something that I can always, not that I'm not proud of anything that I did, but that first solo record came to me, my dog is barking at something. he just turned on that there's a witch hanging over there, and she started rotating because my dog is barking. The Monsters game is barking, so everybody's next. But Sabotage, we stopped playing and after 2002, and TSO was going, and part of me kind of figured that we might be getting to a point where Sabotage was going to be hitting a little bit of a stop there. You know, John wanted to do his solo records, and I was sitting in this house in New York that Sabotage and TSO had for the bands, but I was kind of like the caretaker of the house, and I just started writing, and through the whole glorious world of publishing, I realized that I needed to make sure that when I wrote things, I put it in, got credit for things, because when you write a guitar riff, melodies would come around it, and it's what a singer would do when they heard a riff, but you might have had that melody in your head, or you might have sang it to them, and then when the publishing would come in for songs, you were like, oh, Jesus, I only got X amount, and I wrote this much more, so I started singing my demos, and I was like, wow, I actually, you know, I'm not great, but I sound kind of good, and I wanted to sing when I was younger, but my brother and our bassist in my club band when I was a kid thought my voice sounded really thin and not good enough to sing, so I kind of got discouraged out of it. And I also thought that, you know, everybody was either Ray Gillen or they couldn't sing at all, you know, like I thought you had the voice in you, and so I never really found out that I could learn. But then I started doing the demos. I wrote like 70 songs, and I got a deal with that Greek record company, Black Lotus, and I did my record and finished that, and I think when that record was done, I was just really proud of it. It was the first thing that I did completely by myself, business-wise and music-wise, and got the band together and did the press tour of Europe and this and that. But I also found a lot of the responsibilities of having your own solo band kind of got to be a bit much more than I wanted to deal with, you know, because I wasn't really working with the manager per se in that way, because I had Sabotage's management and TSO's management, so I was handling a lot of my own stuff on my own. It was a little bit draining, you know. After a while, it was just kind of like, you know, I'm going to do my solo records and just kind of do everything. I had so many things going on that I think the pressure of doing all my own business, too, was just something I didn't want to do. But I was really proud of that, you know. I think in the other sense, I think I was really proud when TSO headlined the Garden for the very first time. I think that was something I always dreamed of doing, and to be in that scenario with a band that you were with from day one, you know, and something that was created by Paul with us, you know, was something that you came out of the box with. You know, I played in Sabotage, but Sabotage, their box was already open, you know. TSO was the one where I was in from day one, from show one, so I think that was really a super proud moment to be, you know, coming out of the I lived in Astoria. We were on the road. Paul's like, don't you dare go home without a taxi cab. So I took the subway. He wanted me to take the subway. So, he would always give me like a $100 bill and say, you take this and get in the taxi and tip the guy whatever's left. And a lot of times I try to tip these taxi drivers and they thought the $100 was fake. Because if your taxi fee was $12, there's no way this rock and roll kid Muppet looking guy back's gonna give me an $88 tip. It was funny a lot of times. I might not take counterfeit 100. I'm like, it's not counterfeit. But I actually took the subway to the garden and I got out of that N train tube and looked up and saw a Trans-Siberian Orchestra sold out and it was freezing cold out and I'm looking at that and I was like, all right, that was probably the one of the really super proud moments of my life.
This is just a general question. Again, I know it's hard to answer, not knowing what next year holds as far as touring, but just Chance wants to know, in general, whether it's solo or with any of your other projects, about hitting the road next year.
You know, I don't know what the front's going to be for everybody next year. You know, I'm hoping in a perfect world that everything sets up for TSO to be definitely there at the end of next year. I mean, they say lots of different things about 2021 as far as midsummer, this and that with the vaccine. So I hope TSO winds up being, you know, the little bit of the lucky clovers in that whole batch to where our time of November, December winds up being where everything gets back to normal and we get back out there for everybody. So as far as everything else goes, I'm just going to kind of see what's going on and where we can go from there. I have a lot of different possibilities that keep popping up and things that may or may not happen. I do want to do some solo shows. I'm ready to go out and do that stuff. And I might even go and do some acoustic things at some festivals, but I have to wait and see what comes around, you know, because there's a lot of these big metal festivals that I haven't played in a long time that have the smaller stage places where I could just go out there and kind of do this in front of the fans and have acoustic guitar and sing some songs and play and just, you know, get a chance to travel around and go and see some of the places that I loved and see a lot of my friends in the business. And I can do that without putting together a whole entire band right now and traveling in the middle of everything as it redevelops. So that's some options, but I have to see what's going on next year and then take everything from there.
Cool. And I have a question. When you're working on a project, whether it's solo or with a band, are you an artist that just focuses on the 12 songs in front of you, or do you write 20 or 30 songs when you're working on any record?
Well, that was my problem. My first solo record, I wrote too many, and I didn't know which ones to leave out, so I recorded to like 30 of them, and that's why Faces became Faces Goddamn More, because I had too many songs, and then I didn't leave all the war ones away from the release effects. So I think now I kind of like to have a map. You know, I don't like to go, if it's, say, a record's going to be 10 or 11 songs, I don't like to go too many above 15 on it, and that doesn't mean I won't have 30 ideas, but I'll kind of sit there and go, well, this one's definitely going to be, because when you write a record, you're like, you set up a map, like, this is going to be the slow song, this is going to be the long epic song, and this is going to be the this one and that one and the weird, so you kind of do it that way. And the last couple solo records I have all kind of fell into that format of Faces, to where there's really no general music style. I mean, part of me sometimes wants to do a blues record or something that's a little bit more straightforward, just plain rock, but I don't want to, you know, necessarily do that. Maybe I could put together a band that is just a blues band, but I mean, and those kind of things, it's also one of those things where I don't want to have 90 million bands going on, because that's, like I said, kind of confusing. But, I mean, I guess nowadays it's really going to be one of these things where it's going to depend on how much touring we can do and how many people are there to play with. I'm ready to play again, but, you know, it's just like it's a bizarre for me, because November and December is when I'm always gone. You know, this is the time of the year where most people are home, and this is the time for me where I'd be, right now, it would be 10 o'clock at end of show night, the first TSO tour usually at this day, you know, it's in the middle of November, and I'd be waiting, you know, I'd probably be done and getting ready to go for a signing line and getting back on the bus and getting ready to the next city, and instead I'm home, waiting to see how many leaves fell in the rainstorm. Attack them leaves!
And Jay, it's 10 o'clock. You know what time it is. Top of the hour.
Leave me for a little bit longer. I can cling on to you guys a little more since we started a little late, and I tend to talk too much. So I don't, I don't want, if there's some people's questions that didn't get in, I don't want to avoid them. So.
No, no, not at all. Always, always go down and just make sure that we've kind of answered all of the fans' questions, and then I'll take it back up to Jane. Then on the next round, we'll have more fan questions. So okay. I definitely make sure all the fans get to ask, comment. A lot of fans just want to say, hey, I love your music, I love your record, thank you, which is cool as well.
Sure, absolutely. We're always top of the hour. Just take a quick thank you out there to the sponsors and endorsers that back us and support us in what we do. So we always give some love out to Brad Lee, Angie Kremple, Brad Lee Entertainment, Levy Metal, Levin Lewis, Levy Metal Enterprises, Custom Guitars and Stage Gear, Saren Cadaver of Twisted Vines Horror Decor out of Rhode Island, and Mark and Janet from Rock and Horror Apparel. We thank you guys all so much. We love you to death. We appreciate you continuing on with this journey for us. And anybody who wants to be involved with us, just reach out to any or all of us so we can discuss and see what's the best way to build you guys as we build ourselves. But, so we thank you guys all very much for that. And before we kick it around with another round of the table, Gorgeous Jason, we haven't heard from you yet, sir.
So, Chris, I know that you started, I know you mentioned that you started really young, like you fell in love with music very, very young, but has there ever been a point in your life where you started thinking maybe I should get into something else, or you're afraid that you're not going to make it or make a career out of it? If so, is there anything what would you be doing if you went in that direction, or do you know?
That's the weird thing, I don't know. You know, I was a straight A student. I had a pretty high IQ. I think it was like 156, and I graduated when I was 16. I took my junior and senior year once, and I dove out of being a kid into being a rock and roll musician. I started playing in clubs when I was 15, 16 years old, and luckily for me, kids don't try this at home. I can credit having a brother that was 2 years older than me and a lack of photo ID to me getting the connections that I had in my career, because my brother was 19 when the drinking age went to 21. You were grandfathered in. I was 17. And we had no photo IDs. So I had his driver's license, his credit card, his social security, and I was able to get into clubs that nobody else's. I wasn't drinking, but I was able to get into places in Manhattan, and that's where I met the people that introduced me to Paul O'Neill. So, I mean, like I said, I'm not going to tell people to go use fake ID, but that's seriously how I wound up getting through that. But my mom once said to me something about, were you going to go to college? And my family really didn't have any money. We were pretty poor as far as just being, you know, able to get by things. I built bicycles out of dumpsters. I bought my mom a car when I was 18, 19. I gave her to her down payment. It was kind of a reverse kind of thing. And, you know, I said to her, well, are you going to pay for me to go to school? And she said, no. And I said, well, I ain't going to college. So it was like, I said, unless you're planning on sending me to Hawaii and paying for me to go to school over there, I'm going to just go try this. And luckily for me, I was in the right place at the right time. And I had, you know, an ability and a look that was something that people were interested in at that time. And, you know, by the time I was 19 years old, I had gotten into the Sabotage thing. And you know, when I was 18, I went and actually 17, I played with Heaven, but I got into that. And, you know, but when I was 20, I was working with Atlantic on some other projects they had, that Big Mouth and Dirty Looks, and I got back into Sabotage again when I was 20. So I don't think I ever hit the point where I fell off the wheel, but I think when I left Sabotage to work with my brother, it was a mistake, because I could have stayed in Sabotage and did what I did, but I didn't know that at the time. You know, I was a young kid, and I'm like, I'm going to leave and be a rock star without the band that I was already doing everything I wanted to do with, and I didn't realize that I was leaving the band I wanted to be in, you know, until I got out of it. But what I did when I was 22, I just wanted to make sure that I took my guitar playing to another level. So I kind of slept and practiced a lot more, and I left from being, you know, Chris Caffrey, the kid that was kind of, you know, Chris Oliva's backup guitar player, to the one that was Chris Caffrey that played with John Oliva and Dr. Butcher, just by kind of doing, like, you know, 13 hours a day of just playing. And I ran into this friend of mine that was actually working with Ray Gillen. His name was Albie Romano, and he had a thing called Sun Red Sun. And Albie was a brilliant guitar player, and he had a very expensive guitar collection, and he would get guitars and gears to really famous guitar players and get tricks from them. So Albie had learned from Uli Roth directly, and Michael Schenker directly. His mother had him have guitar lessons when he was a kid from Leslie West when he was really young. And so Albie had, you know, Yngwie, Michael, all these people had taught him things. And he sat down with me and really helped work with me on my guitar playing, just to be in some of the frame of mind that came out of some of those guys that, you know, we all worshipped when we were little kids playing guitars. Funny the way he said it, too. I don't know if anybody ever saw this, but I was sitting in his guitar studio room in his house, and I was playing. He goes, let me hear you play. And I was playing, and I was a decent player at that time, and I wasn't going to end the world, but I was as good as probably, you know, a lot of the people I was in my bands with, other than people like, say, Chris, but I mean, some of the other bands. But I played, and he looked at me, and he said, so how long you been playing like a girl? So he took the guitar I had or whatever, because I think I brought a guitar to his house, and he gave me this Gibson Flying V. It was a Carina White V that Leslie West bought for him, and it had really heavy strings on it, and he gave me this 1/12-inch Fender Princeton amp, and he said, when you can sound the way you're playing out of this with all these pedals and this, that, and everything, out of this guitar straight into this amp, then we could talk. And he just taught me how to get the sound out of my hands, and the fact that that cycle of sound comes from your arms on that guitar neck, you know, that strength of really digging and pulling and getting that out of your guitar. And that kind of really affected me a lot, I think, as far as how I went into guitar. And I just took myself to being like, you know, I don't want to leave this as far as being my job, and that's what I'm going to be doing. And I think that's where I got lucky with that, and I did Butcher with John, and then unfortunately Chris had passed away, and, you know, me and Al got into Sabotage, and then Sabotage just started to take back off again, and then TSO flew out of that, and everything just came out of that whole cycle of being involved with Paul O'Neill when I was a little kid. You know, I was a 17-year-old, got one of the greatest writers and producers in heavy metal and rock on as his father, basically. Paul was like my mentor, you know, and took me under his wing and made almost everything anybody wanted to try to happen in their lives and career. And I was very fortunate. I never took that for granted, you know, ever. I never do. I still bust my ass, and I would always work. You know, I never take anything I do for granted. I'm not a spoiled rock star. I'm just Chris Caffrey. I'm the kid that loved what he did when he was little, the same way he does now. And I would work just as hard now if I had to. You know, when I do, I always work. I don't consider myself somebody that will ever stop working, even if I could. I just like to work and play music and do art and make people happy.
When you're honest,
you have a tendency to anger people every once in a while, but that's just me.
Hey, that's all right. Well, if they can't handle it, then fine. There's not really a place for them here. Mm-hmm. But since you were talking about art, though, and that you've always been so into art, that actually kind of leads into my next question, just because I thought about it today while I was actually walking around in the Baltimore Museum of Art, and I was was thinking about the interview, and I was thinking about the fact that between your solo projects, your solo albums, TSO and Sabotage, you guys have released some pretty, like, epic album covers, some, like, just really eye-catching, well-designed album covers. And I'd love to, for you to talk a little bit about, like, for example, the Jester's Court and where that design came from and who put it together, because it's pretty sick.
It was one of these things where I had an idea for that cover. And it's funny because he's sitting in front of my Your Heaven Is Real record cover, which my German record company, they were getting me art for that record, and the art that happened, something fell through with it, and they needed to release, and they just came up with that at like a last minute. It's not my favorite cover ever, but when I had the ideas for Jester's Court, I had the idea of that I wanted to have kind of this Jester playing chess over kings and queens and controlling something like that, and I was trying to get them to give me art like that, and they sent me something that was so bad. No offense, but I was like, I can't use this. So I started going online and looking for the ideas I wanted, and I put, you know, Jester and this and that, and that cover art came up.
Oh.
It was Court, and I'm like, that looks like the idea I had, but with cards instead of chess, and I had somebody research it for me and found the Russian artist, Vladimir Barkov, and we became good friends online, and he did that and some of the interior art for that, and all the actually artwork on that record is his, and he's just an amazing artist, and he's the one who did, you know, the stuff that I have for Wilbur, like his Christmas ornament stuff. That's Vladimir's art. And
nice.
He did a lot of things for me. He's just a brilliant, brilliant artist. He was a musician that was an artist too, and he's, you know, he's way better at an actual artist than I am in that way, and he's just, I was glad to get him out. I've actually got a couple of my friends have had record covers done by him. You know, Sabotage, we had Gary Smith when we had those old records, and we had Greg Hildebrandt with TSO. I mean, that was a blessing. He did all that Star Wars art, and he does all the TSO stuff now, and his artwork, he has that Night Castle guitar and all those things. The graphic art I have on my guitars were his, and he's just a brilliant artist. So you get lucky. I mean, some of these people, you know, I feel guilty when I get their artwork sometimes, because it's like, it's such a beautiful thing, and it's like, I feel it should be in museums, and it winds up, you know, in a painting on my wall and just on some t-shirts. I'm like, this stuff should be in a museum. Some of their stuff is so priceless, and you know, I work now with my glass art and things like that, but it's, you know, I really have a true amount of respect for people who can go and visually do that. There's a friend of mine, his name's Brian Bancroft. He lives up in Cortland, New York, up where John West is from, and he did a lot of my tattoos, and he's one of those people that can draw each one of you to look just like you. You know, if he was with black and white pen with like a pencil. And so some people can do exactly what the eyes can see. Me, I had, you know, the ability to be able to cut things out of sea glass and make cartoons and do my art and do, you know, things like the gingerbread houses and stuff I do out of the glass art, and you know, be able to cut and design, like, you know, elephants and things like that out of the glass that I find in beaches and rivers and things, which has been good for me, because that's something that I really enjoy doing. I just escape into that, and I've actually made and produced over 140 pieces of that glass art in the last 3 years that people have in their homes now, so it's been a lot of fun for me to do that stuff.
That's awesome, for sure. Yeah, because those albums are so beautiful. They're so cool. And when it comes to, like, Sabotage, I've always been very partial to the Edge of Thorns album cover. I thought that was just really, really cool with, like, the girl sitting on the water. I just always thought it was beautiful. But, yeah, Chris, I'm going to swing the table, brother, because we definitely want to be respectful of your time. So, Psycho Steve, take it away.
Okay. So, out of all the places you've played, is there a bucket list place that you haven't played?
Yeah, there's a couple.
Okay.
Australia being one of the ones. Sabotage never went to Australia. I mean, we never. I know we have a lot of fans out there, and a lot of people have started the play. I think that's one of the ones I'd really like to get to. I also Sabotage, because Sabotage went to a lot of the places I wanted to go. We never made it into Russia, and I know a lot of people have played over there. And I did some stuff with Dora, but I never had a chance to do her Russian dates. I just love a lot of the Russian art and those, you know, when you want to see those really cool looking old buildings. And it's not that I want to see the Russian fans, but I mean, you know, at the end of the day, you want to see all the places that you saw before again. But there's still a list of countries that I didn't get to with Sabotage that I think I'd love to get to. Some of the more southern countries in South America that we never got to, Argentina with Sabotage, or Chile. And, you know, I just know that those are all really big metal places. I mean, I'd love to play in the Middle East. There's so many heavy metal fans in the Middle East. I talk to kids and people online, you know, a lot of places they can't even speak sometimes. They're not allowed. But I know when we played, I think it was Bakken with Sabotage, one of the first times, there was a kid that came up to me and said that he came in from Egypt. And he told me that there was a Sabotage cover band that played in Egypt and near the pyramid somewhere. And there was like 40,000 people watching the Sabotage cover band. And they talk about that. But there's just a lot, you know, those kids are, they see music differently than we do. I think, I don't know, call Americans spoiled. We have so many things in America, you know, we get all the time. A lot of these kids, that music is all they have, you know. When they would hear things like Paul's lyrics, like Believe, and those really, they would tell me how they saved their lives. And I think some of those places, even like Syria, you know, they've been, you know, a lot of war and had a lot of hard times. And I think there's a lot of kids that I'd love to go perform to and watch their faces, because the amount of energy they get, I think it's something we see a lot of times in places like maybe Greece or Brazil, where these people just give you every ounce of their soul in the audience. But I know that there's a lot of those kids out there that go through a lot of pain every day in their lives for things that we, I don't say necessarily take for granted, but I think that we don't get a chance to realize just how lucky we are sometimes, you know, compared to some of the other places in this world. And I think those are some of the places I'd love to play.
Awesome. That's killer. Absolutely. Bobby Dreyer, sir.
So with you working on all these projects, is there, and you're taking care of your mom, how do you juggle that? I mean, you know, family, career, you know, and I commend you for that, you know. So, you know, that's great.
I don't sleep a lot. I think that's one thing people go, oh, it's 2020, you could probably sleep more, but I don't know. I don't really, a lot of times I'll be up to like 3-4 in the morning, and I'll just be working on my art and stuff like that till real late. And then I get up, my dog will wake me at 7:38 in the morning, and then I'm just up, and I'll be working on that. But I think you just need to try to find a balance. I spent a lot of time when I was younger having friends hanging out outside of the music. You know, you'd finish, and I would be out. When I lived in Astoria, I'd be in the bars and doing those things. I eliminated that part of my life, and I think it was for the better. I stopped the drinking side of things, you know, which for me, I think as you get older, the energy that it draws out of you the following days, I think be something that would eliminate the ability for me to do everything. And it's also, you know, in times has created a lot of difficult situations in your life that maybe shouldn't have happened. I mean, some of the funniest things in my life that have ever happened because I was out with my friends being really foolish and stupid. But I think some of the stupidest things that have ever happened in my life were times when, you know, maybe when we even lived came out of those, you know. Yeah. You know, I found it, I think it's maybe been one time since the middle of 2018 that I drank. And I think even in the midst of that, you find that you open your mouth and you let things out that you're like, oh, it's just kind of one of those things. So I think it's, you find balance within yourself. You not saying it's necessarily like you're growing up. You just learn that, you know, you focus your attention on where it needs to be. And when somebody else's life, like my mom's, is there, and in general, you know, being around other people, I try to help people as much as possible. Like I said, I'm not perfect. You know, I tend to be honest sometimes. So if something bothers me, I'll open my mouth and give my opinion. And that's a difficult thing to do because the world's got a lot of sides, you know. And when you're a musician that plays in different bands, you have people that fall onto all different sides of things. So you have to be careful with that, but not everybody's perfect. So, you know, you're going to eventually, somebody's going to see things that you say or feel that they may not agree with. But I mean, we're human beings and that's how it goes. But I don't try to live with that side of life. I try to learn from my mistakes and hope other people would do that too, because that's how we become better as a society, is when we learn and work. And I think that's the one thing that's gotten me to where I've been able to get in my life is that I've always been learning, whether it's on my guitar or in the business side of things or as a human being. I'm always learning something, you know. And that's they say knowledge is power. Well, I think that, you know, I'm not looking for power. I'm just looking to be able to be a better person a lot of times. And I think that knowledge helps balanced to doing all the things that I do. And I do sometimes get really super exhausted because a lot of things will happen at once. You know, when I'm looking at needing to leave to work with GSO, and all of a sudden I've got to balance that along with everything else I'm doing, and you just, time flies by, and I don't know what the heck they're doing with just turning the clock back stuff, but it's dark at 4:30 in the afternoon, and I'm stuff inside, and I'm like, why can't you just leave the clocks alone? And so it's, you know, you check some balances, you find what you can do, and I'll get done with this with you guys, and I'll probably be up work until 2, 3 in the morning on some art stuff and music stuff, and so that's just how I do. I like to do things late at night when the world's kind of slowed down, my time to do things like that.
Absolutely, definitely understand that. Jason, yourself, friend?
Yeah, I definitely agree with you about being the most creative at night, because I'm the same way. Although I can't really stay up late, but when I do, you know. Is there anyone that you haven't played with yet that you would want to? I mean, it could be living or dead, it doesn't matter, but is there like anyone that that you would want to play with or even work with that you haven't had the opportunity to yet?
You kind of hit the nail on the head with the living or dead one with that. I mean, if there was the one person I always wanted to do an album with, was Ronnie Dio. And that never happened, but we came really close a few times. I was basically right behind Rowan Robertson to get into Dio at that point in time. And recently, in the last years of Ronnie's life, we'd always spoken about this, and his personal assistant, Steve, he told me when I saw him at a Ronnie Dio charity thing after he passed away, that, you know, and it's something that Ronnie had actually told me all the time, that, you know, we're going to do this, but he said that Ronnie was saying to him that, you know, I've got to get this record done with Chris one day, because he wanted to do it. He knew how much I did, because I told him I wanted to really give him, you know, a Dio record he'd be really happy with for me, just because of how big of an influence he was to me. My first tour ever was opening for Dio, and he was just such a somebody I looked to, up to, in everything he did, whether it was Sabbath or Rainbow or Dio or whatever. He was just such a person that I idolized, and I think Ronnie Dio is probably the one that hits the top of that list over anyone. It would be him, without doubt. You know, when he died, I
cried like a baby for hours, and it was not necessarily a selfish cry. I knew that opportunity with him would never happen, but I also knew that the world was losing somebody that was very special out of all of our musical lives. And, you know, when summer tours came around, you were doing festivals, and we're like, oh, Dio's on this one. And we just, you'd see Ronnie, and it was just something special about him. He was such a great person. He was such a great musician and performer, and that was definitely a huge loss for me mentally, because I lost a lot of my soul along with his death. It was kind of like, oh, wow, it was a big part of my life passed away with that man, which had been that way with a lot of the people close to me, like with Paul and Chris Oliva, people that were that close to you as a person as well as creatively and musically. I mean, it's draining, you know, when those parts of your life go along with the, you know, the other ones.
Absolutely, for sure. Before we kick to Angel real quick, just as a quick little follow-up, do you communicate much with Wendy still?
Not a whole lot. I saw her when TSO was doing some of its Beethoven stuff, and every once in a while I'll speak to her about things, but I need to touch base and just say hi to her. I mean, I'll talk and say hello to people like Simon and other people that were close in the Dio circle, but I haven't really. I mean, she had some projects she wanted me to do. You know, Wendy's one of those people that likes to assemble people. And I remember when she saw me, she pulled me aside after one of the shows. She said, I have an idea. If it was you and this person on vocals and this one on drums and this one, it'd be beautiful. And it was, all right, Wendy. But yeah, she, it was funny. Every time I would see her with Ronnie, Ronnie's like, my wife likes you more than she does me, because she would sit there talking to me. Ronnie's like, but it was just one. I just knew her since I was a little kid, so, you know, they were a family to me, the Dio, so.
Absolutely. Oh, that's super cool. Angel, all you, friend.
Okay, a question from Shanna Ramirez. If Sabotage isn't working on projects, can there at least be merchandise sold?
I think there are merchandise things out there, and a lot of times we don't know about them. But me and John kind of got tired of my dog is barking at the monsters and the witch again. I think, come here, get over here.
I guess he wants merchandise, yeah, too.
The same thing, the monsters has gone through its cycle, which kicked on the witch, and his barking sets the witch off. I'm gonna fully stop bar and I don't drink. This is the joke. Hey, would you please stop it? And you're being rude. You're being rude. You know what that means.
I'm out.
He wants attention. And he's telling me this has been too freaking long. He's been, I don't know if you noticed, he's throwing him a ball. So he's, ball, get over here. Get it. He's a German Shepherd. I don't know if any of you guys have ever had a German Shepherd.
I think he wants to be on TV.
Yeah.
Can we make him a guest?
On Chris's next episode.
I'm not sure Motley would like that.
I saw Motley earlier.
This is the villain I'm talking about. Now he's squeaking the ball. I don't even remember the question now. That's how. Where was I was German Shepherd interrupted. What was I saying?
Sabotage merchandise.
Oh, okay, yeah. So yeah, I think sometimes. Well, John the other day said, "Look at this really cool Sabotage leather jacket," but I said, who's making that? He says, I don't know, but I think I'm going to buy it. So we just get to the point where people make things. It was kind of like with bootleg records. I'd have people email me. I would like to, if you're a friend, I'm doing my French. I would like, I'm from France, and I'm telling you about the release of my record, Sabotage Live in Paris. And I'm like, you're emailing me to tell me that you're stealing my music to make a live record. So it was just funny, like, you'd go to Italy and they'd have the merchandise, the mafia merchandise, and alongside of the venues you were playing. And you just, I'd be sitting there bartering, giving these guys handfuls of guitar picks to get t-shirts, because some of their bootleg stuff was better than ours. So I know we're doing a vinyl re-release of a lot of the Sabotage records in 2021. I don't have any all the details on it, but I know that's happening. So, and I saw the internet was flooded with a bunch of things. I think Al did an interview and they asked him some questions, and he said John has been writing, but John's always writing. So, you know, I like all the people who like Sabotage would love to see a Sabotage reunion. My dog just missed the ball and knocked it on against the wall. So, but yeah, that's as far as the merchandise. There's a bunch out there. Just some of it's ours and some of it's somebody else that's gonna make money off it.
Yeah.
You can contact PetSmart about making balls for to have dogs play with.
My dog had a Kong endorsement. The Kong company, I sent him pictures of him, and he got a giant box of Kong toys, and it's completely spoiled.
That's a smart dog.
Bobby, yeah, listen up, boy.
Like I said, I don't know if any of you guys have ever had a German Shepherd. They're different than any dog I've ever had in my life. It's my first Shepherd, but they're human. They're completely different than that's when they say that GSD thing. You don't understand it till you have one. They're definitely different.
Brad wants to know, how many guitars do you take on a TSO tour?
Good question. Usually 10. I have a lot of space, and I have two guitar coffins, as we call them, and I could fit. And I usually take, I usually will have 10 when I go out there. Some of them stay in there and never leave. I have guitars that have been in those things for 15 years. Other than the tour, I don't see them. I have one Wizard guitar and my Beethoven guitar and a couple of those ones with the tigers on. They just stay in there because, you know, I wouldn't play them if they were home. And I made that mistake a long time ago. I was like, oh, I'm going to play all these things when I get home, and I might need a photo shoot for this. And so you'd take all these guitars in their cases, and you'd carry them out to your car, drive home with them, and it'd be January, the end of the first week of January, when the trucks drop the gear off, and you get your stuff and go back home, and then you turn around, and it's the middle of October, and management's like, well, you need to put your guitars, whatever guitars you're using, and you're like, now I got to carry these guitars that I never touched back to my Jeep, bring them back to the warehouse to put them in the case that they could have just stayed in, so now they just kind of stay there, and I'll pick up new ones every once in a while. Last year was the first time in a long time I picked up a decent amount of guitars, and I used them all. I just, my friend had a Gibson V, an Explorer. There's like this emerald green for sale that he bought a long time ago, and he's like, I'm dumping these things. He's a singer, but it's like, I bought them, and then I wound up eBaying an emerald green SG, and they were out on my last so tour. And then I bought the gold Strat. It had been like a pretty long time since I had bought guitars, since I had so many different endorsements and so many ones that I really had loved, that me being the guitar buyer. But then I was laughing about it this year, because I'm like, there I go, last year, after not spending any money on guitars for all these years, I go dump the cash last year and fall into the year when we stop working. It's like, what is that about? So I just sit there, how's everything with money? I'm like, well, you know, if I wasn't such an idiot with buying guitars and I don't want to sell them, it's not like I need to. But it was just kind of ironic that of all the times that I went to go and say, yeah, screw it, I'll just buy a bunch of guitars, and then turn around and like, oh, well, we're not playing. So it was just really ironic with that. I was like, that was really, really funny. A couple things happened with that kind of situation with me. With past year, when you pulled into the like whole you're not working thing, some things I did last year that I if I had any idea that we weren't going to be working this year, I wouldn't have done them last year. But it's not that huge of a problem. It's just the irony involved, like things you held off doing for so long. You're just like, yeah, I'll do that now. You look this year, it's like, why did I do it last year? So.
We have Star Peters. He wants to know, is there an artist you would like to collaborate with that we would all be surprised by?
See, that goes back into the artists that aren't alive anymore things. But, I mean, there was a lot of ones I really like, you know, the Freddie Mercury and the Princes, the people that wrote really bizarre arrangements and things like that. I really like those kind of writers, you know, ones that think a lot, you know. There's a lot of the modern musicians that play, ones we've known for a long time, like the Portnoys and stuff like that, that have really good imaginations and things like that. I mean, I there's a lot of singers that I work with that I one day would love to do records with, you know, people like Russell and Soda that are just really good singers, but they always have so many different other things going on. But you know, speaking of, you know, people like that work with, I'm a big fan of Richie Kotzen too. It's like, I think he'd be somebody fun to do something with, because he's such a great singer and musician. I think he'd be a fun kind of person to maybe do like you know, the Pat Travers Band kind of thing with, you know, the two guitars singing, playing, doing some stuff. Just ones that you wouldn't expect, because he's somebody I just really respect a lot as a musician and player. You know, he's one of those ones where I remember when his solo stuff first came out, and I heard him sing, and I didn't know it was him. And I was like, who the heck is this singer? And it's like, he's one of those people that kind of falls in, like, not necessarily me, because I don't, you know, my voice is what it is. I kind of use it like an instrument, but where I'll see him release music, and then you'll see some people say, wow, that guy sings like, you know, the guy from Soundgarden, he's amazing, and then other people are like, ah, he's okay. And I think that just comes down to him being a guitar player that sang. A lot of times, if you just did that, if Richie Kotzen was just a singer and not the guitar player, it's like, imagine where he would be in the world of vocalists, because that voice is so amazing. But it's just kind of how that goes sometimes. But there's a lot of different people I'd love to do that with. And even the guitar players I work with, like Al or Joel, would be great to do a record like that, where it was just two people doing some cool heavy blues rock songs and making that. But there's, you know, that list could probably go on forever. I've spoken to the Metallium guys about maybe doing a new record with them, and me and John are always talking about writing and doing another Butcher record. But those opportunities are there, you know. In the meantime, I just do my solo stuff and kind of just hang out and be happy. I've got tons of music that's never been released, and some stuff I forgot I even wrote. I'd find cassette tapes and things and be like, I'll be listening to a cassette tape of a song I wrote 20 years ago, and this is a really cool tune. Who is this? And then I'm like, did I write this? And he'll go and find it, and it was one of my songs, one of my writing tapes, and I'm like, I didn't even remember writing that song. And I was like, wow. Muhammad Ali, brain damage, brain cells view. It was sort of Eddie Murphy comedy thing. He had that line about, you know, somebody just took so many hits to the head that you didn't remember. But yeah, I sometimes forget what I did. But there's a lot of people I'd like to work with. You know, I could probably go through different genres of music and say, hey, I'd love to work with that person and that person. But, you know, all depends.
I'm just going to have Kim Sullivan do our last fan question, then I'm going to kick it up to Jay. You have a line of hot sauces. What's your favorite flavor?
The hat, you see. High River sauces. Well, I mean, as far as the ones I've made, some of my favorite flavors are ones that have not been released yet. I've got a couple Thai ones and other ones that people haven't tried. But Tears of the Sun that I released was the one I think that most people really are familiar with as far as my sauces. I mean, when I started working with Steve Seabury and he developed High River Sauces, his whole plan with me was to make sure that we didn't do what a lot of people did, which is stick the musician's name on the sauce and be like, Chris Caffrey is this, because, you know, his whole plan was to make High River Sauces become a really prominent sauce company, which he's done. And the good thing about that is you get, you know, but from the food critics and the foodie world, they look at your products and they think of you as a hot sauce company rather than a musician that had the hot sauces. So, you know, my
hot sauces wound up in a lot of grocery stores and things like that. And that's a lot of fun when you wander into a grocery store and you go up that aisle and you look and you'll see that, because there's no more record stores. So it's not like I can go through them all. Like, oh, see if my new store records here. I'm like, there isn't anybody's records there. It's not like it would be mine. There's just no more record stores. So it's fun with the hot sauce to be able to get to, you know, Pepper Palace in the airport, and your hot sauce is there. It's kind of like the old days of having Harmony Hut and you know, Sam Goody, when they had all these record stores, and your records that you were making were everywhere. You know, that's kind of fun. But I like all the different flavors of hot sauce. It just depends kind of on what I'm eating, really. People ask me why I made hot sauce, and I said, well, I wanted to find a way to be a pain in the ass to people at all times. So I got to the hot sauce business, so there was that one.
Dude, that's super duper cool. But Chris, we can't thank you enough for taking some time and taking some extended time to be with us tonight, man. I mean, your stories were great. They were so cool. Let's
thank him, because you took his time. He was ready to get to work. He was ready, so it's Wilbur's hours here. So, but no, thank you guys. This was a lot of fun. I actually had texted and muted some of the things that had to go on at the hour of 10, so I can get to do. A lot of things are popping up, you know, as time goes and we get closer to the crunch time with TSO. I have a lot of things that come up that I don't even know about to do for them and stuff. So it's good though. I'm happy to be talking to you, and I'm happy to be going back in one way to see the TSO fans and in the midst of this. And you know, we're getting into the winter. Everybody, you know who you are, and you know what you can do and what you want to do. Just be respectful to the people around you. That's all I can say with this one, because you know, it's not necessarily your life that you may save by doing the right thing. Now you could save somebody else's, or somebody else's mother, somebody else's grandmother, and then that's the kind of the way I look at it. It's really not asking for too much. We're almost out of the woods with this. You know, I figure we probably got another 6 months of some real weirdness, and just praying that we don't see any weird mutations, and we can get out of this with as little lives lost as possible. You know, so everybody just stay respectful and stay smart, because that's basically all you can do. I mean, it's one thing to be able to do what you want for your own life, but it really doesn't take a whole hell of a lot right now to be respectful to other people's lives. It doesn't take a lot. It's not asking for a lot. It really isn't. You're not suffering that bad by doing the right thing. So
absolutely. In the words of Psycho Steve, #, it's not a task to wear a mask. So we thank you guys all so much. The Metal Summoners, we love you guys to death. All the Sabotage fans, the TSO fans, Chris's solo fans, we love you guys all so much. Thank you so much for tuning in. Like us on Facebook. Like us on YouTube, so you can see all of our old pages and all of our old interviews and all that stuff. Like, subscribe, follow YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. For the Metal Summoners, we love you all so much. For Jason, for Angel, for Bobby, for Psycho Steve, I'm Jay. Again, for Chris Cafferty, thank you all so much. Announcement on Friday. We'll see you next week. This has been the Metal Summit.